you were wondering how you could get a climate motion through your credit union branch, you have immediately printed out some for you, which are at the on the table back at the back. So, our next speaker is Maya from Platform. Yes.
Hi there, thanks for having me speak. So I'm from Platform, which some of you might know, some of you might not know. We've been challenging the oil and gas industry and working on fossil fuels for about 22 years. But a lot of our work is about how we build a just transition, how we build energy democracy, how we take back control as workers and as citizens. Now, we all know that the violence of climate change is ultimately driven by the choice to keep burning fossil fuels. It's an outcome of centuries of colonialism, of capitalism, but those decisions aren't in the past, they're in the present. They're constantly being remade by powerful people in this city, as well as in DC, in Brussels, in Philadelphia. Building that alternative future is part of stopping them making those decisions, but also building that future that we want to live in, we think people believe in. Three things I'm going to talk through quickly are North Sea oil, public offshore wind, and finance. So in terms of oil, we all know, and it's almost just sitting there all the time, but we've got to leave 80% of fossil fuels in the ground. But it's tempting to dump that responsibility onto places that are far away, onto Venezuela, onto Saudi, onto Nigeria. We tend not to think about our own responsibility to draw a line in the sand. Okay, we do in terms of fracking, because that's a new thing, and we say, okay, no fracking. We also need to recognise, if we're showing leadership within the UK, then we have to face up to North Sea oil, to what we do about stop limiting extraction. So on the existing basis, we're pouring public finance, we're pouring subsidies into North Sea oil all the time. If you look at BP's last report on the tax they paid in different countries, in the US they paid $500 million, in Australia they paid $200 million, in the UK BP paid minus $189 million. That means that we paid them a net transfer to take our oil out of the ground. And it's a lot of our unions, including one of my unions, Unite, who are supporting subsidies. Unite, GMB, IOT have repeatedly said we need more subsidies. Now, of course, we all know that yes, we do need subsidies for energy, we do need public funds, but we need to move it into renewables in a way that enables that transition to happen. And we need to do that quickly, because there's 5.7 billion barrels of proven reserves in the North Sea. So 80% of that is staying in the ground. It probably should be more, given our past history as the UK. But if we do say let's extract 20% of that, that means we've got to stop extracting by Christmas next year. It's pretty soon. Some of us have been saying this for 3.5 years. It's always shifting. That's a big deal that isn't really being spoken about. But the conversations about those rapid changes, they need to take place not just here, but also in places like Aberdeen, in the northeast coast of Scotland. Because those changes will require, or should be framed around the desires and needs of communities in Aberdeen. Job losses are already a reality because the oil companies are slashing jobs and they're using falling oil prices as an excuse, as a reason. And even when we throw more subsidies at them, they keep slashing the jobs. But we need those skills. We need the capacity of Aberdeen as a whole and of the offshore oil workforce. We can't allow a repeat of the devastation that took place when Thatcher shut down the coal mines. We need to fight for equivalent jobs, equivalently paid, equivalent standards for every worker in the polluting industry like North Sea oil. And Corbyn actually committed on February 10th in his speech on climate change that every energy worker would get an equivalent job in the new economy. But we can't stop there, because actually when you spend time in Aberdeen, you realise quite quickly that there's about 30,000 people who work offshore. But there's three times that number that work in the supply chain. And then there's also a lot of people who work, drive taxis, clean hotels, work in the cinema, and their jobs are there now because of the oil industry. So when we talk about changing the economy as a whole, we need to think about communities collectively. It is about people working in the fossil fuel sector, but it's also about the communities that rely on them. So we need to think about, okay, well, how do we build our transformation? And the Million Climate Jobs pamphlet has a lot of detail in there. But we should also recognise that we can start building the institutions that can make the just transition possible. We don't need to wait until Jeremy and John and Barry walk into Downing Street. So, for example, in the UK, more offshore wind has been installed than in any other country, and there's going to be a whole lot more built in the future. But just because we've built a lot of offshore wind in our water, doesn't mean the communities are benefiting. It doesn't mean that the jobs are located here. So there's a report, I think all the copies are gone, but it's online, called Who Owns the Wind, Owns the Future. And in it, we worked out that actually half of the wind off the coast of the UK is owned by the public. But it's not owned by the public here. It's owned by the Swedish public, and the Danish public, and the German public, and the public of the city of Munich. 0.07% of offshore wind is owned by the British public. That's one turbine. It's a research turbine. It's only sort of offshore in the first place. It's kind of on the beach. And this building public offshore wind is perfectly feasible and quite efficient. And cities like, in fact, there's a large offshore wind farm off the north coast of Wales. 30% of it is owned and built by the city of Munich, by their municipal energy company. So it makes me go, well, if the city of Munich can build offshore wind off the coast here, exactly, then why can't Birmingham, or Manchester, or Glasgow, or Newcastle? And when Andy Burnham says that he's going to set up a public energy company, and a lot of the folks on public energy companies, it's going to cut bills, etc. And okay, we absolutely have to cut bills. But let's say to Andy, great, but that public energy company should also be building turbines. It should also be putting solar panels. It's about building that infrastructure right here and right now, so we can start doing it. And when we have those public energy companies, they are the institutions that make the just transition possible. That's where those equivalent jobs or equal pay are, from moving people from one sector to another. How do we pay for it, for that whole transition? So, of course, when John and Jeremy and Barry and everybody walk into Downing Street and everything, and when the left has, you know, more influence, then there's going to be, in the Labour manifesto, there's £250 billion worth of infrastructure or access to infrastructure spending that will come through borrowing. But, again, right now, already, local government pension funds, over £200 billion worth, the railway pension fund, over £25 billion worth, those are pensions of union members, of RMT members, of TSSA members, of Unison members, of Unite members. And we as union members, A, those are people's pensions that need to be protected, but also they, union members, have voice in shaping what happens to that money. And at the moment, just in the local government pension scheme, there's over $15 billion in fossil fuels, in BP, and Shell, and BHP, Billiton, etc. It's possible to take that money out of fossil fuels, say we're going to stop driving extractive multinational exploitation. We're going to stop handing that money over to the City of London so they make all the decisions. Instead, we think those decisions should be made by people whose pensions they are, by the workers and by the local community. So some boroughs, like Waltham Forest and Southwark in London, have said that they are going to divest. And Merseyside, I think, have also started to say that they might. There's a process there. I think there's another. It's not enough to just divest it. It's also going, okay, how do we harness that, those pensions, making sure that they are invested into the real economy, into building things that people that are very practical, and that will also deliver very solid pensions for a long time, because that's essential. That can start now. So, to conclude, there's been, I think, we all know that climate change is an existential crisis. But again, just because it's scary doesn't mean that we need to wait for central government to be able to start building those alternatives. And those alternatives can be transformative, whether it's one, divesting, two, starting to build institutions, whether it's public energy companies, also worker public partnerships like Sam has outlined in the PCS briefing, going, okay, how do we pull together worker controlled entities together with public entities? Three, as trade unions, we need to be building the pathways to retool industry. So when you see Corbyn's speeches, he talks about how workers are going to be running the publicly owned industries of the future. You know, the energy sector, the water sector, when they're taken back into public hands, workers will be shaping how they run. But then, that's great, but let's start shaping now how we think we're going to transition those industries. Going, okay, as workers within those sectors, as trade unions, how are we going to build those pathways for changing the energy sector, changing the water sector? We can start that now, and in the process, we can prove that we should be running these entities, that internal democracy works. And the fourth, that within neighbourhoods and communities now, our cities, as trade unions, we can make the plans on how we may move away from fossil fuels and carbon. In Aberdeen, it's very hard to think about what Aberdeen looks like beyond oil. But once you start doing it, like when I've asked people, is there going to be oil in Aberdeen in 2040? People say no. So if you say, well, let's work out what Aberdeen looks like beyond oil, suddenly it becomes much, much easier to fight for that future, to build that future. And I think million climate jobs, actually we should ask ourselves, it's absolutely essential that we have national plans, but also we should be able to articulate locally what is this going to look like, specifically whether it's in Aberdeen, in Birmingham, in Hackney. Let's not let this existential crisis be taken over by corporations. They are definitely trying to shape it in their interests. Instead, we can use it to build something better, to take power of corporations, to take energy into public hands, and to reclaim democracy.
According to wealth, and it's actually the top 10% richest people in the world who are responsible for 49% of carbon emissions. And that presents us with an immense challenge because it shows that we need to have a much more equal world if we're going to tackle climate change, but also an opportunity, because it shows that actually there's a relatively smaller group of people in the world that need to take the biggest action to get us on track. I just want to say a few things about what Friends of the Earth is doing and how you can get involved. The first thing is about getting on track for 1.5 degrees and ramping up the UK's ambition to take action on climate change. I'm sure you'll have talked about the Paris Agreement and its strengths and weaknesses, and Friends of the Earth is very proud to have been the instigator of the UK Climate Change Act, and when I first came to Friends of the Earth nearly 10 years ago, that's the campaign I worked on. So I was a part of the political unit campaigning to get this new legislation adopted in Parliament that would commit not just that generation of politicians, but Parliament after Parliament to ongoing tightening of our carbon emissions. And it really was a kind of historic intervention which reframed the debate about climate change, not as a nice to have, but as something that should be a binding commitment year on year. And it really had an international impact, was part of the thinking behind the international agreements on climate change. But what we're faced with is that our commitments here are not nearly tough enough, not nearly ambitious enough, if we're going to take our fair share of action. So this year is going to be a really critical year for the UK government revising its scale of ambition on climate change, and we are we're behind the scenes putting legal pressure on the government to tighten its carbon targets, but we'll be campaigning all year to put pressure on them to do that. Alongside the kind of the numbers, we need to get to kind of practicalities. Clearly we need to get off fossil fuels, as you've heard from other colleagues, and we've got huge campaigns for a fossil-free country. We have been working side by side with anti-fracking campaigners, and I know you've had Tina Louise Rothery here today. I think she's left now, but an absolute anti-fracking hero. And Friends of the Earth has stood by communities across the country facing fracking. We've got an extraordinary legal team that we and expert planners, and we work with communities to help give them the legal support and knowledge and skills about how to use the planning system to stop fracking. But we also have experts in the fracking technology, so that we can support communities to fight these fracking interventions wherever they happen. There's just some really brilliant news just coming out week after week. So Third Energy, that has been trying to frack in Rydale, only this week we heard that they have announced that they're going to suspend fracking until October of this year, and they've got their kit together and were intending to frack in October of last year. And it's through a series of interventions, of legal action, and standing side by side with the communities that we've been able to kick that down the road. You'll have heard probably from Tina Louise about Preston New Road in Lancashire. And again, it's a series of coordinated interventions. And there's an image there about Sherwood Forest, because the fracking company Ineos got licenses to frack across the whole of the area of the Midlands around Sherwood Forest. And it's extraordinary. It's like there is nowhere that is sacred, and they are trying to force fracking on their communities there. We're campaigning against it. And I think it's really worth reflecting in terms of jobs. The fracking companies say, you know, this is good, we need fracking for energy security. You know, this is somehow they claim it's a low carbon transition fuel, which is nonsense. But they also claim that it will produce, create jobs. And you know, the actual, when you look at the figures, there's an average of 11 jobs created per well, and that's just pitiful compared to the opportunities that come from the rocketing renewable energy sector and the alternatives. So in terms of jobs, there's no future for fracking, but also there's no future for fracking because everywhere the fracking companies say they want to frack, communities stand side by side and they say no, and we're on the winning side, they're on the losing side, and there is no future for fracking in this country. The next one I just want to say very briefly about Drewridge Bay and coal. coal. You know, coal also is on the losing side of history, and but we can't wait for it to die of its own accord. We need to intervene, and there's a really critical decision that the government's going to make any week now around a huge coal mine in Northumberland in Druridge Bay. There's a picture of that Druridge Bay there, and the government has come under huge pressure to reject this new coal mine, and indeed they've been forced to kind of call it in and make it a central government decision based on climate change. And Friends of the Earth has had a huge campaign to try and get that coal mine stopped, and 10,000 people have signed a petition, and I really would urge you to add your name to that petition, and let's put the last bit of pressure on Sajid Javid before he makes that decision. We've heard a little bit about the funding of fossil fuels, and it's just extraordinary, isn't it? You know, these decades after humanity has understood that climate change is driven by burning fossil fuels, and yet now the UK government is still investing, is funding fossil fuels to the tune of $5 to $7 billion dollars a year, and that's mainly on gas, but over a third of it is on coal and petrol as well. And so the you know, everybody who's involved in the divestment campaigns, in your workplaces, in local communities and with councils, that's absolutely essential. But also our government has just got to stop funding fossil fuels. I mean, it's just, when will this become obvious to them? I just want to say a couple more campaigns that are really involving very large numbers of people, and one of them is our Clean Air campaign. I mean, you'll all be completely familiar with the, you know, why we have such polluted air, and it's about the internal combustion engine and particularly diesel cars. And Friends of the Earth's got this really innovative citizen science tool on the right hand side in there, which is our clean air kit, and it's all about how people can monitor air pollution in their own area and then put pressure on decision makers to say, look, actually, you know, we need to phase out diesel, we need to have clean air zones. And again, it's where does the government put its investment, and where are the jobs of the future? And the jobs of the future absolutely can't be in the internal combustion engine. They need to be in a new generation of public transport and electric vehicles. If everybody's really familiar with the root of plastics and why the world is awash with plastics, and it's no accident that this has happened, and it's all about the super profits that the fossil fuel industry have been driving by producing these plastics and selling them to us as though there are no alternatives. And INEOS, the fracking company that is, you know, a blight of the Sherwood area, is one of the companies that, one of the justifications about why we must frack Sherwood Forest is because that we need the fossil fuels to produce more plastics. And I think we will all agree that this is not a good idea. Very lastly, I just wanted to kind of return to the justice issue, and Friends of the Earth is very pleased to have joined trade unions in supporting a statement for a just transition. And Friends of the Earth, here we're working with trade unions, and in Friends of the Earth International and across Europe, we're also working with trade union partners, because we really, justice does need to be at the heart of our solutions to climate change. Also, I want to encourage everybody to take part in UN Anti-Racism Day, and Friends of the Earth will be on the big demonstration because the millions of people who are already at the front line and facing the impacts of climate change, and this is only going to increase as we have locked in climate impacts, and we need to have a just solution for jobs, but we also need to say no to the racism that accompanies the climate change debate. So I'll finish there. It's a bit trite, but you know, it's people that change the course of history, and it's brilliant to see so many people here who are coming together, who completely reject the framing of you know, drawing a distinction between jobs and just future and tackling climate change. It's only just solutions that are going to be that are going to work for people on the planet, and it's great to see so many people united for that. Thank you.
Secretary of PCS Union, which has been one of the most
First of all, thanks very much for the invitation, and thanks to all of the organisers, and PCS, I think as you indicate there, was very pleased to have been able to play the role that we have. Without the Campaign Against Climate Change trade union group, who brought together trade unionists in environmentalists, I don't think we'd be having this conference, and I don't think we would have developed the 1 million climate jobs and all the sort of alternative thinking that has developed as a result of that. So I think, you know, it's played a very important role, and it's great that I can attend, speak, bring the solidarity from my own union, the PCS, 180,000 members organised in civil service, public bodies, and in members working on private contracts. And we, I think, have played a very important role in recent years in fighting austerity against the job cuts, against the pay freeze, against the office closures, against the privatisation programmes, all inflicted upon our members and public servants and the public who rely on these services in the name of so-called austerity. And it's for that reason, I'm sure I'm not the only one in this room, who was enthused by the outcome of the general election, and in particular the publication of the manifesto, which in many ways I would regard is a turning point in British politics, the inspiration it gave to millions of people to hear arguments against austerity and the impact it's had on so many young people in generating levels of political activity. It's absolutely inspirational. But the Tories desperately cling to office. They are terrified at the implications of Jeremy Corbyn, John McDonnell government, despite the spectacle of them almost visibly crumbling before our eyes. The fact of the matter is, there is no respite. They carry on the cuts in the civil service. They're carrying on the cuts in local government. They're carrying on the cuts and privatising the NHS. And my union has had to contend with a twin attack, an attack on conditions of employment and an attack on our union rights. They're the only union in the UK where they cut the time that our reps have to represent our members. A leaked document, literally in a brown envelope, was published for discussion at the HMRC, that's Revenue and Customs Board, that discussed how to achieve the organisational degradation of PCS's capacity to represent its own members. And we've also had to contend, the only union in the UK, with the removal of the long-standing method of collecting our subscriptions. Now, of course, our answer has been to sign up members on a massive scale. We defied the attempt to break us. We've challenged the various attacks that are inflicted upon our members, and in a pain battle we continue to work with those other unions that are serious about organising a fight to secure decent pay and conditions for public sector workers. The reason I mention this is because PCS is attacked for the same reason that the British trade union movement is tied up with a panoply of anti-union legislation, often in defiance of provisions of universal, any definition of democracy within our society. They don't attack us because we're irrelevant and we're relics of the past. They attack us for precisely the opposite, because unions stand in the way of the elites in our society making working people pay for a crisis that we didn't cause. And I want to equally pay. It's very important, I think, that we recognise the marvellous strike of the college lecturers, forcing the employer back to the negotiating table, an absolute inspiration. The attempts of the Bakers Union to historic strike of workers working for McDonald's. And we should also recognise the outcome of the battle in the Communication Workers Union, who smashed the government's 50% threshold. A decisive vote for industrial action and Royal Mail forced back to negotiate to introduce a new pension scheme to increase the pay and provide job security. That is a concrete classic example of what the unions at their best and why they're so important. And they're so important because they shouldn't just be defensive institutions. Unions have historically always been agents of social change. And when we're under attack, and when we see the climate under attack, this is an opportunity for us to not just say what we're against, but what we're in favour of. And that's why PCS is involved, for example, in campaigns around tax justice. Let me just say about our work PCS is proud to work with the Tax Justice Network and UK on costs. The reason I mention this is that we organise workers in revenue and customs. The chief executive of revenue and customs at a recent public accounts committee acknowledged that the cuts, office closure, digital programme, its attempt to apply tax compliance is not credible. The chief executive of the second biggest department responsible for collecting the tax in this country says the government's programme is not credible. And let me just give you a few examples. 25 to 125 billion. HMRC, we lose about 25 billion. Very, very conservative estimation. We think with UK on cut, the Tax Justice Network, it's closer to £125 billion a year is lost to the public purse as a result of tax avoidance and tax evasion of the super rich and the FTSE 100 companies. The richest 1,000 people since the financial crash have actually seen their wealth double over the time when we're all supposedly tightening our belts. Let me give you 2016 as an example. The richest 1,000 people in that 1 year alone saw their wealth increase by £28 billion over that one year. That's £77 million a day increase over that 1 year. And that's enough to pay every single council tax bill in the UK to create 2 million minimum wage jobs and 1 million more public sector jobs paying a minimum of £27,000 a year. We produced a report, this is PCS, relied on our tax inspectors we organised, who also show that you could pay 100 times over for the international tax compliance officers that are needed if you were serious about chasing the tax dodgers, who don't just dodge Britain, but of course are involved on an international scale. The reason, apologies for that slight meander, but the reason I mention all of that is that it's absolutely important that we do everything to show, to destroy the myth that on the seventh richest economy on the planet, we can't afford to invest in schools, in public services, in social care, and in the subsidies that Mika and others have talked about that's needed by government to tackle climate change. It shows it never was about affordability, and always was about priority. Now, PCS is one of a growing number of unions that recognises the climate as a trade union issue. A motion was carried at the TUC. It doesn't always necessarily change the world, a motion carried at the TUC, but it was a highly significant move by the Bakers Union, supported unanimously by all of the unions, that commits the British trade union movement, at least technically, to action on climate change, to promote public ownership of energy, and to put workers' interests at the heart of a just transition. And all of the speakers in the food industry, in the transport sector, in construction, in unions like Unison and PCS that have members in regulatory and enforcement bodies, of unions like the FBU and in the emergency services dealing with the consequences of extreme weather, all showing that climate is a trade union issue. And it helps us, and others have mentioned this, we've got to deal with this false choice between jobs versus climate. There can be no compromise, I would argue, on the basic trade union role of fighting to defend militantly and tenaciously the pay, jobs and conditions of our members. But there's nothing incompatible with that. And again, as Mika indicated, with Aberdeen and the oil industry as an example, we need to work with the unions that not only have the technical expertise, but these unions with union power and considerable influence, and it's working with these unions in developing alternative industrial plans that is the way forward. Because the real threat to workers on the rigs and in the gas industry and energy-intensive industries doesn't come from the climate movement. It comes from a Tory government, a rigged and privatised energy market, energy giants and transnational corporations who dominate the market, who rip off the consumers and cause 2.3 million families and plunge them into fuel poverty. And it's why it's so important that the trade union movement works together, the public and the private sector, fights and calls for the public investment that makes the call for public ownership. And now is the time to do that. Privatisation is a failed experiment, and the people of Britain recognise that. We're now in a much better position to argue for public ownership at a governmental, a regional, sectoral and municipal level, and to argue that we need firm, union-backed public guarantees for the workers affected in energy-intensive industries if we're going to make the gradual but fundamental and necessary transition to a zero-carbon economy. Now, PCS produced reference has been made to the Just Transition pamphlet. It doesn't seem to answer everything, but I think it's a very useful contribution. It shows why climate is a trade union issue. It shows the role of public bodies and public agencies that will be needed in a transition, and it shows the importance of engaging workers across all of the sectors. It builds on the inspirational example, for example, of the Lucas Plan, which again showed an idea before its time of greater relevance now, the importance of workers in sectors to use the knowledge and their union power, but of course it demonstrates that it never was enough to simply protest outside a factory or an energy intensive industry without engaging in a dialogue with the workers and being able to put forward a credible alternative. And I really just want to finish that building on the 1 million climate jobs initiative, which various people have referred to, we're going to do, again, Mika referred to this, we've got to now replicate that initiative on a more localised basis, which is exactly what we're seeking to do on the Fylde Coast, working with the Bakers Union, the Blackpool Trades Council, Frack Free Lancashire, anti-fracking protesters, the Campaign Against Climate Change trade union group, Reclaim the Power, and looking to replicate the 1 million climate jobs idea on a localised basis. And of course we realise that the movement against fracking on the Fylde has been an absolute inspiration, and I want to pay tribute for the work that's done on that campaign. But we keep hitting on against the false claims of Quadrilla and the industry about the jobs that will be created, and that they create a false and grossly exaggerated picture of the potential benefits. And we will continue to fight against fracking, to support the mass civil disobedience that's going to be needed to stop the drilling. But we're about to publish an initial report that shows in a resource-rich area like the Fylde Coast, coastline with abundance of wind and wave power, rather than rip up the countryside in Little Plumpton, and rather than the government overriding the decisions of local councillors, and rather than legislation that makes it easier to frack than it is to invest in clean renewable resources, and rather than rely on a gas industry where we're dependent on the deliberate creation of government policy after attacking the NUM, rather than that, instead, let's invest and develop a plan for offshore wind technology, look at the investment needed, the energy generated, access to the grid, utilising port facilities of Fleetwood, the role of local councils, utilising wind power developments in the Celtic array off the coast of Cumbria, of energy efficiency, retrofitting, insulation of homes and public buildings, use of solar panelling, extending a clean public transport links by developing the tram network on a very flat terrain, looking at the use of electric cars and bus transports and cycling, developing skills and training programmes through the universities and further education college, instead of the miserable 420 jobs, and even that's exaggerated, we are going to develop and produce a plan that shows thousands of permanent, skilled union jobs can be created that can have an impact on developing one of the most deprived areas in the UK, arming the anti-fracking argument and showing that another alternative is possible. So thank you very much for listening. I hope you enjoyed that.
In sort of statement on transition in the UK. So far, various organisations, including the unions, NAU and PTS, have signed up to support. And if you'd like to find out more, Google Green Job Alliance or talk to Graham Stendhal, can't we? Thank you, everyone, for coming, and go away and keep up the good work.